you so very much and welcome to another hour of Georgia Championship Wrestling. And before we get into the program today or even tell you about any of the competitors, we'd like to remind you once again that time is running out on the most popular wrestler contest. So if you have a favorite wrestler and you'd like to have him win the trophy that we will be presenting to the most popular wrestler, may I just say that you should get your vote in as quickly as possible. It's very simple. Just write down the name of your favorite wrestler on a postcard. No letters, please. A postcard only. And then send it to this address, 100 Techwood Drive Northwest, Atlanta, Georgia, 30303. That's 100 Techwood Drive Northwest, Atlanta, Georgia. A zip code is 30303. Just include the name of your favorite wrestler and your name and hometown. Now, during this next hour, a lot of great action coming up. We're going to see a new tag team combination, George Wells and Wrestling 2 in action. Also, the superstar, the national heavyweight champion, will be seeing action. Tommy Wildfire Rich, the Georgia heavyweight champion. Kevin Von Erich, a man who's looking for titles and, in my opinion, is going to garner some in the very near future. Also, we'll be seeing the Georgia tag team champions, Terry Gordy and Jimmy Superfly Snuka. All of this action upcoming during the next hour here on Georgia Championship Wrestling. So by all means, do stay tuned. And we'll be back with our first match right after we pause. Wait a minute. Let's turn it right over to our ring announcer at this time.
Thank you, Gordon. This first match will be 10 minutes. Introducing this tag team event, first of all, from Cuba, now living in Tampa, Florida, at 240 pounds, here's David Sierra. Sierra. His tag team partner, from Milano, Italy, at 241 pounds, Tony Russo. Tony Russo. Their opponents from Oakland, California, at 245 pounds. Here's George Wells. George Wells. His tag team partner at 237 pounds. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Wrestling number two. Wrestling number two. Your referee is Nick Patrick. We'll be back with this match after this brief timeout.
George Wells moves out first now against Sierra. This match, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. All right, they lock up collar and elbow once again, and... opponents that time, and that shows you the tremendous dexterity of this man, George Wells. Russo and Sierra facing Wrestling 2 and George Wells. Wells in the powder blue trunks. Sierra, 6'2". He's a big man, caught by a shoulder smash by Wells. Now Wells up and over his man. Sierra caught him, a beautiful hip toss, but Wells breaks it up. And it is Wells. Hip lock takedown into the side headlock. Sierra, by the way, in high school and all, competed in baseball, football, and in wrestling. He's held the Pacific Northwest title. Wrestling 2 moves in there against Sierra now. Thing about Sierra is he is exceptionally dangerous. He'll go for that Boston Crab, the full Boston Crab, which is a very, very painful hold. And he enjoys moving in that direction. So Chu and Wells both are going to have to watch him very carefully. Russo also in the black trunk. Sierra's tag team partner. Good shoulder smash by Wrestling 2. Sierra drops to the canvas. Wrestling 2, set and ready. Tip lock takedown. Wrestling 2 keeping the side headlock. Russo in there now against Sierra. Wrestling 2 catches him, a good shoulder smash, makes the tag. George Wells moves back in. Wells from Oakland, California. Wells powered off the rope, catches Russo, a good shoulder smash, drops Russo to the canvas. Hip lock takedown back into the side headlock. He lost that side headlock momentarily, but recouped it very, very quickly. And you can hear the chant being picked up by the crowd now. Let's go, George, let's go. Full Nelson by Russo, but Russo, yes, did not have that firmly clamped on. Wells up and over his man into a hip lock takedown. Russo bullying Wells back in, makes the tag, and Sierra, a cheap shot on that tag, using that forearm, and Sierra can be a very dangerous man indeed. In right hand, good fly, drop kick by Sierra, has Wells down. Tried for a lateral press and a far leg hook, but Wells broke free from it. Sierra catches him, a chopping right hand, another forearm. Now Wells explodes, and both men exploding on each other now, and it is Wells with a right hand that finally puts Sierra to the canvas, but it is Sierra headbutt into the midsection of Wells that drove him back into the ring ropes. And some double teaming going on now. Nick Patrick, the official, having his problems trying to keep them separated. Russo drives a boot to the midsection of George Wells and a knee lift under the chin that drops him to the canvas. And again, the crowd chanting, let's go, George, let's go. They're with this man 100%. And George Wells responding to that, but now gets over. Trying to make that tag. Did not make it. Knee lift that staggers Wells backwards once again. Wells caught from behind by Sierra. And Russo, a forearm across the chest. Now Wells retaliates, one to the side of the jaw. Headbutt that staggers Russo. Wells somersaults over, makes the tag with Wrestling 2. Wrestling 2 moves in. And Wrestling 2, a series of hard right hands that puts Russo back to the canvas. Backdrop has Russo in trouble again. Lateral press, and now it's a Wrestling 2 tagging up with George Wells once again. Wells using that elbow effectively. Wells grabbing Russo by the head. Now set to arm whip him off the ropes, does so. A left hand to the midsection. Knee lift, the glance is off the chest. Wrestling 2 moves out there once again. Wrestling 2, a hip toss that puts Russo down. Wrestling 2 up. Well executed head scissors. Russo into those ropes, and now it's Wrestling 2 making the tag with George Wells. George Wells moves out. Off the ropes. Wells caught him with a point of the shoulder. Makes the tag with Wrestling 2. Wrestling 2 with a knee lift. Down to three. Down to three, and it is all over for the team of Russo and Sierra. And so your winning combination is Mr. Wrestling number 2 and George Wells, and an impressive tag team combination indeed. I want to take a moment right now to talk to Steve O. Before we get into this conversation with Steve, I'd like to remind all of you that beginning next week, Georgia Championship Wrestling will be on the air every Saturday night from 6:05 until 8:05, and that, I might point out, is a permanent starting time. Steve O is with me, and of course, here's a man who I've followed his career with a great deal of interest. He comes from an entirely athletic family. His dad's a former pro football player. He's got a brother who's a pro football player. Steve, of course, is in the sport that he really prefers above all, and that's one-on-one body contact. But I understand now that in your grasp for further knowledge, that you've been undergoing a rather secretive but intensive training regimen.
Well, that's true, Gordon. You know, I guess no secret is well kept around you. I'm going to try to keep it now for a little bit longer. In professional sports, everyone tries to strive to improve himself constantly. And when I was teaching, I tried to, you know, constantly put that thought into the minds of the students. When I was just starting professional wrestling, I started out, you know, putting up the ring, refereeing, learning the profession from the ground up. And now, as you progress in life and progress in the sport, you have to continually improve. This is the approach I have always taken. Things have come down in professional wrestling where sometimes you become predictable. When you become predictable in the ring, people know what's coming up offensively and defensively. And now I am trying to improve myself, but come up with a new twist, so to speak.
Well, we're talking about this. Of course, here's a man who I guess a lot of people looking at him say, well, he's got this tremendous background. He is an accredited teacher. By the same token, you don't believe in sitting back on your laurels at all.
Well, no, you know, you have to continue to try to improve it myself. Also, you know, it's nothing really unusual from any other professional wrestler. Everybody's out there trying to think of something they can do to make themselves more money, to make themselves more popular. And for me, the time has come.
Thank you so very much, Steve-O.
What are you doing, Doctor?
I'm trying to find the secret of comedy.
Now that formula's already been invented.
That we'd like to have you jot down in a convenient place, maybe on your calendar. Put down the time 6.05 p.m. That's right, 6.05 p.m. And, well, Freddie, that's the time from now on.
Tonight, the Omni in Atlanta, 8:30, a sensational card. Such stars as Kevin Von Erich, Mr. Wrestling number 2, Steve-O, George Wells in these matches. 400-pound Chris Cannon against 300-pound Bruiser Brody. Georgia heavyweight title, Tommy Rich, champion against the superstar. And a special challenge, eighth wonder of the world, Andre the Giant and Michael Hayes, the fabulous Freebird, against Snuka and Gordy. There are good seats available. That's tonight, the Omni, 8:30.
Okay, the superstar, the national heavyweight champion, getting set to move out against Bruce Gallagher. Now, the superstar is perhaps one of the most well-rounded athletes that you'll ever see in the ring. Facing Bruce Gallagher, I might just point out that Gallagher caught very quickly, and the superstar unleashes a very, very quick all-out offensive against Gallagher. Rear chin lock now by the superstar on Gallagher. Gallagher battling his way back to his feet. The superstar, 6'4", will step into that ring at anywhere between 260 and 270 pounds. Front chancery now on Gallagher. Keeping that front chancery now, modifies that to an underhook of the arm into a takedown. Gallagher powers his way out. Superstar once again back to the front chancery. Here's a man, and I do know this much about him. I do not know his identity, but I do know enough information to know that he was an outstanding athlete in football, track, basketball, and wrestling. Has his master's degree, I might add. He has his master's degree in education. He has held co-holder of the NWA Georgia, or the NWA World Tag Team Championship. Co-holder of the Georgia Tag Team Championship. He's held the Far Eastern Championship, North American Heavyweight Championship, a host of titles. And uses, of course, the Cobra hold with great effectiveness. Once again, with the rear chin lock. Gallagher up against those ring ropes. The referee calls for the break. Referee with the count. Up those ropes, caught him coming in. Referee again calling for the break on the superstar. Superstar brings him up, full body slam. And and the superstar did not allow the pinfall. Possibly had his man, did not allow that pinfall. Takes him down with a neck breaker. Again, bringing the man's shoulders off the mat before the count of three. And he is a firm believer in issuing out as much punishment as he can. Caught him coming off the ropes. And now moves into the Cobra hold. Moves into the Cobra. The pressure put, just as is on the sleeper, the pressure put on the carotid artery. And the referee very quickly calls for the bell. The minute he sensed darkness closing in, he immediately called for the bell to avert any possible serious injury. And so the superstar, the North America, or the national heavyweight champion, moves out of this match victorious. And a bit of a confrontation. I had asked Tommy Rich to come out after this match, and we almost had a confrontation over there between the superstar and Tommy Rich. I want to take a moment or two to talk to Tommy Rich.
I want to ask you a question. I want to know why. Yeah, big, tough superstar, boy. He's real bad. Go out there and take advantage of somebody like that. You know, why ain't you got the guts to put that title on the line? That's what I don't understand, Gordon. Seems like every time, you know, superstar, he wants a shot at the Georgia heavyweight title, but yet he ain't got the guts. He don't got the guts. He won't put the national title on the line. Well, superstar, what I'm asking you, if you're so sure of yourself, why won't you put the title on the line? I don't care where it's at, Atlanta, Georgia, Columbus, Ohio, Huntington, West Virginia, Columbus, Georgia, it don't matter, superstar. Anywhere in the country, all you got to do is name the time and the place, and I'll be there.
Well, there you have it. Certainly a wide open challenge to the superstar for that National Heavyweight Championship, and it does appear that he has been, since winning that title, sort of resting on his laurels a bit.
Yes, he has. He had defended it one time, Gordon, and the way it seems to me, he's just picking his opponents, you know. Like last week, he's out here, I'll give Snake Brown a shot. He ain't giving nobody a shot. What I'm saying is, superstar, if you're such a man, put the title on the line. Let's just really find out how bad you really are.
Well, let's also take a look at what's going to happen tonight at the Omni here in Atlanta. Match time is 8:30, and plenty of good seats are still available. Tickets on sale at the Omni box office. Jimmy Superfly Snuka and Terry Gordy going up against Andre the Giant and Michael Hayes. And then you, Tommy, putting up the Georgia Heavyweight Championship against the very man you're talking about, the superstar.
You know, that's exactly right. I went up to Lake Lanier this week, took it easy, Gordon, and I'm ready. Superstar, just like I told you before, Saturday night, that is party night in Atlanta, Georgia. So what I'm planning on is coming down to the Omni, giving you a good whipping, because just like I said, I ain't forgot about you busting my head. So I'm coming back for you to pay some dues. So superstar, you better be ready tonight. And you know, Gordon, in Columbus, Ohio, it's going to be one of the first times Michael Mahes and myself is going to be teamed up. I didn't think that'd ever happen, but it's happening in Columbus, Ohio.
It is indeed, and I certainly hope that all of you will make your plans. For those of you in Columbus, make your plans to be at those matches. And for all of you here in the Atlanta area, be sure to be at the Omni tonight at 8:30. Tommy Wildfire Rich going up against Rick Ferreira. Tommy Rich, the Georgia heavyweight champion, and an electric brand of wrestler, if you will. One of the most exciting youngsters to come down the pike in a long, long time. By the way, I would like to take an opportunity to thank so many, many of you who have been so kind as to write in letters and comments about the matches, and we certainly appreciate it. I don't have an opportunity to answer all of those letters personally, but I can assure you that I read them personally, and I'm very gratified to hear from so many of you. I certainly want to wish Brenda Middlebrooks a very, very speedy recovery. Tommy Rich breaks it up as Ferreira tried to press an advantage there. Rich back on his feet. Rich wearing the silver and red trunks. Ferreira in the blue trunks. Ferreira, born in France and educated there. Tommy Rich, of course, from Tennessee. Ferreira missed with a right hand. It's Rich bringing him up. Full body slam. Let's go, overhooks the head, and you might have a stalemate situation here as both competitors down on the mat. The referee, Nick Patrick, watching them carefully. Nick Patrick, by the way, has quite an the official has quite an impressive amateur background in sports. Arm drag and twist by Tommy Rich. Rich now, short forearm to the side of the head. Keeps that arm drag and twist going on Ferreira. Rich off the ropes. Good reversal by Rich. Into a hip toss. Ferreira back on his feet. An arm drag takedown. Ferreira gets the head scissors. Rich tried to slip away. Ferreira blocked that very nicely. Ferreira suffered a broken nose in a match last week, but is back in action once again. Of course, broken noses, jammed fingers, jammed knuckles. These, although they might sound exceptionally serious, in the ranks of professional wrestling, pro boxing, football, you name it, these are minor skirmishes to these athletes. They all contain a very high threshold for pain. And in fact, the matter is, I can say of professional wrestlers in particular, because I am more intimately acquainted with their lifestyles, that these men, for the most part, live in pain in one form or another. I can't think of a wrestler who competes that walks into that ring that he doesn't hurt somewhere. And Rich now putting some hurt on Ferreira. Was off the ropes, a high backdrop. Ferreira tried to roll off to one side. Rich crashed down, but it was Ferreira driving those knees into the abdominal cavity of Tommy Wildfire. Rich now a lateral press. Rich powers out before the count of three. Ferreira caught him, a kidney-type punch that time. And Ferreira working on the lower portion, the lumbar portion of the back. Now Ferreira chopping right hand to the side of the head. Another one across the spinal column. Now, a side chancery by Ferreira. The crowd, of course, solidly on the side of Tommy Wildfire Rich, but Rich has his hands full with Rick Ferreira. Atomic knee drop that jams the spine of Rich once again. Again, Rich is able to power out before the count of three. Rich caught him with a headbutt coming in, but it did not faze Ferreira. Ferreira moves back in. Has Rich, arm whips him off the ropes. Caught him in a bear hug coming off the ropes, and this could be trouble for Tommy Wildfire Rich. Ferreira, the shorter of the two men, but extremely powerful upper body, and has Rich at the base of the rib cage. Has caught him in the base of the rib cage, and that'll be forcing him to expel air. Rich gets inside of him, however. Moves to a hip toss. Rich comes off the ropes. A good drop kick by Tommy Wildfire. Rich caught that time by Ferreira. Ferreira trying to go for that full Boston crab. Rich breaks it up. Rich closes in once again. And a standing abdominal stretch. A standing abdominal stretch applied by Tommy Wildfire Rich Ferreira. Those muscles being pulled in all the wrong directions very quickly concedes your winner, the Georgia heavyweight champion, Tommy Wildfire Rich. Every Saturday thereafter, Georgia Championship Wrestling will be on the air at 6.05 p.m. every Saturday afternoon. A host of accusations have been hurtled toward the superstar regarding his national heavyweight championship. The fact is that a lot of the other competitors seem to feel that you are not defending that title. Admittedly, you only have to defend it once every 30 days.
You know, there's a lot of individuals, and Tommy Rich is the head of the list, and Steve O, the ex-champion, wrestling number two, George Wells, all these men say, through the matchmaker, they contact George Scott and say, we want a championship match, the National Heavyweight Championship, against the superstar. Now, I gave a directive to Mr. Scott last week, and I mentioned to you that I've made up my own list of potential matches. Snake Brown's on that list, Mike Fever, Bunk Harris. There's a long line I think I mentioned 20 individuals. There are top contenders for my belt. On the bottom of that list, you find individuals like wrestling number two, Tommy Rich, Steve-O, the former champion. You know, once you're knocked off the top, you got to go all the way down to the bottom of the ladder and work yourself on back up.
Well, of course, tonight at the Omni here in Atlanta, beginning promptly at 8:30, the Georgia Heavyweight Championship goes on the line. Now, Tommy Wildfire Rich is in the same posture once every 30 days, and yet
Tommy Rich is a lucky man. That is, until this evening, Tommy Rich, I have been waiting and waiting with you on my mind. Now, you made the boastful statement that you were out at the lake resting all week. You must need that rest. You must need the relaxation. You didn't look too good just now. Well, I haven't been resting. I put three people in the hospital this week, and you're going to be the fourth. Right here in the Omni, this belt's not at stake, but your Georgia Heavyweight Championship is. You're not going to be lucky two nights in a row. I've got one match and one man to think about. That's you, Tommy Rich. Your championship's at stake. I'm coming after you tonight. I've waited a long, long time, and I'm going to take your belt home right here in the Omni.
There's the bell. Jim Nelson moving out against Kevin Von Erich, and here are two outstanding athletes. Nelson, the shorter of the two, probably giving away some reach to Von Erich. Von Erich in the yellow trunks, Nelson in the black trunks. Kevin Von Erich, 6 feet, 2.5 inches tall. Hits the scales at around 230 pounds. Von Erich dropped down, thinking to possibly get a single leg pickup or an ankle sweep. Nelson was watching him carefully, and a good back out by Nelson that time as Von Erich went for an ankle sweep. All right, collar and elbow, but Nelson very quickly turned that into a top wrist lock, has Von Erich down to one knee momentarily. Von Erich caught in a position here, did not have the leverage, but they're into those ropes. The referee calls for the break, a good clean break. Kevin was born in the Yukon in Yellowknife. Of course, has made his home, many years in Texas. Went to the Denton High School and, of course, to North Texas State University. Has his degree in forestry with a minor in biology. Second generation wrestler and an outstanding athlete. So you've got a tremendous... Nelson catches him with a head scissors. And Von Erich is facing some problems here. Good hip lock takedown, but Jim Nelson once again moves into that head scissors. This thing about Nelson, you've got to watch him. He's very clever, very adept at the ring. Snapmare by Kevin Von Erich. And Kevin Von Erich using that elbow very effectively. Now to a rear chin lock on Nelson. Nelson, shorter than Von Erich, is from Roanoke, Virginia originally. Went to Northside High School there. And a good series of moves by Kevin Von Erich that gets Nelson trapped into a hammerlock. Nelson, I might point out, is quite a motorcycle enthusiast. He's been wrestling professionally for the last 3.5 years and has moved extremely well in his chosen profession. Referee Nick Patrick checking. They're into the ropes. The referee calls for the break. Nelson back on his feet very quickly. Collar. Nelson drove a knee to the midsection. Then overhooks to the front chancery on Kevin Von Erich. keeps that front chancery, and so Kevin Von Erich, who is undefeated thus far here on Georgia Championship Wrestling, facing some very tough competition here, but now escapes from that, gets a full arm drag and twist, now uses the forearm across the deltoid muscles of Jim Nelson. If you look at Kevin Von Erich closely, you'll see Matt Burns on his elbows, marks on his legs. He has that one problem, as I pointed out. He lacerates very easily. Man, this, of course, can be damaging. Kevin Von Erich now tiring of the tactics of Nelson. The beautiful forearm that rocked Nelson into a snap mirror. Dick Nelson back to the canvas once again. Von Erich crashing down across him. A count of three. Kevin Von Erich putting the full brunt of some 230 pounds, catapulting down across the chest of Jim Nelson, scoring the pinfall. The victor, Kevin Von Erich. Well, we just watched Kevin Von Erich in an outstanding match against Jim Nelson, and Kevin, congratulations. I may say, must say this, that I think Nelson started to give you a run for your money.
Well, he was a tough competitor. You know, one thing about wrestling here, I really love it because I've been winning my matches in a scientific-type manner. And that's the way I've been brought up, to win them that way. And everything's been going great. Going for me good here.
Well, it has been indeed, and I might just point out that Kevin is one of those two who is seeking that national heavyweight championship that the superstar seems to be just holding back on. Legally, he has 30 days with which to defend that title, but
I think just a second. Nobody cares. Nobody cares what you love, boy. You know, I know that you come from a wrestling family, boy, but nobody cares about that. And I know, I checked your records, boy. You've won 100 matches in a row without being defeated. But nobody cares about that. So why don't you just bug off, boy, and let some men do the talking?
You're starting to burn me, Gordy. I've been under it twice now, and you've interrupted my interviews. I'm not afraid of you guys. I'll take either one of you. You got belts, and I want both of them.
Listen, all you got to do is listen to us. It's not what you got to say. It's what we got to say. Is
hey, that's right, baby. That's right. So why don't you just bug off? And, boy, if you want either one of us, it don't matter. It can be arranged.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. I think that's quite enough. And obviously, I apologize, Kevin, for the interruption by these two.
No apology necessary, Mr. Yeah,
I'm right, no problem.
No apology necessary because, you know, that's what it's all about.
Well, I can understand how you feel about that. And I may just say, too, that it'll be curious. I'm curious to see if either one makes
sense. I've been interrupted on here twice now, and I'm getting a little bit burned now.
Thank you so very much, Kevin Von Erich.
Ladies and gentlemen, this tag team event, one fall with television time remaining. From Knoxville, Tennessee, at 215 pounds, here's Keith Larson. Keith Larson, his tag team partner from Florida, at 205 pounds, Denny Brown. Denny Brown. Their opponents are the Georgia tag team champions from the Fiji Islands at 245 pounds, Jimmy Superfly Snuka. Snuka. His team partner from Chattanooga, Tennessee, at 270 pounds, Terry Gordy. Terry Gordy.
All right, it's Terry Gordy and Jimmy Superfly Snuka going up against an outstanding combination here in Brown and Larson. One fall, 10-minute time limit. Gordy moves in and his man ducks away. Australia, hey, good duck under, go behind, and Gordy very quickly slipped away from that. As we said, of course, this is an Australian tag team match, and the Georgia tag team champions, Gordy and Snuka, out there against this combination. There you see Terry Gordy. He is a brash, sometimes overconfident man, but he certainly backs up everything that he says. There's no question about that. trunks, taking some punishment here. Keith Larson, full body slam on him. And thing about Gordy is he is a tremendously impressive young man. Big, powerful, and now, of course, Jimmy Superfly Snuka moves in. Snuka has to be, in my book, one of the most dangerous opponents ever to grace a wrestling ring. Wide step-over stance with the armbar by Snuka, keeping Larson tied up. Denny Brown has not yet had an opportunity to tag up, and Larson should indeed get over and tag up as quickly as he can. Gordy and Snuka both delivering boots to the shoulder and to the rib cage. Larson. Referee warning Snuka about getting back and holding onto that turnbuckle. That is a critical point. Forearm into the chest, another forearm on Terry Gordy. And Gordy looking like somewhat like an enraged grizzly at that point in time. Good block by Gordy. Jeff Larson from getting over to make the tag with Brown. Larson off his feet once again. And Snuka, considering the experience he has, the physical conditioning that he has, still will resort to those shortcuts every opportunity he gets. They are, in fact, however, the Georgia Tag Team Champions. Snuka explodes again on Larson. Snuka, 6'1", right at 250 pounds. He's been a professional wrestler for the past 10 years. Larson now using those forearms, and I'm sure at this point would like to get over and make that tag with Brown. Makes the tag, and Brown moves in. Now, mind you, Brown is yet to be in the ring, so he is completely fresh. Gordy takes a lot of steam out of him in a hurry. Gordy brings him up high, vertical souple, and Brown has to be stunned from this. Snuka, off that top rope, crashes down across him. Full body impact on Brown. And Brown still doubled up, I'm sure, still trying to get oxygen into his system. Terry Gordy sets him for the pile driver. Delivered that pile driver. And I can't believe that any competitor is going to get up from that. And he did not. Brown demolished by Superfly Jimmy Snuka and Terry Gordy. And I do mean demolished, certainly no question about exactly what happened just then. The Georgia Tag Team Champions proving once again that they are indeed an extremely dangerous combination. And I must admit, gentlemen, that your victory certainly was impressive.
Did you see that, Gordon Soley? That right there goes to prove that we can't get no competition around here. You know, I know Michael Hayes, he went out and he got Andre the Giant to be his partner. But that's still no competition because, you know, Andre the Giant, he's got the size and he's got the strength, but he ain't got the speed and he ain't got the agility. He's too clumsy.
Well,
see what I'm saying, Gordon?
Gentlemen, first of all,
and in the Omni,
let's talk about the Omni tonight. You say the man doesn't have the agility and all. May I point out to you that Andre the Giant has played soccer, rugby. He moves exceptionally fast.
I don't care, Gordon Soley, a man that big, he's got to be clumsy. And you know, look at us, look at our size. We got the strength, we got the speed, we got it all. And in the Omni, Andre the Giant, you're gonna fall, boy. And every time you go to get up, you're gonna fall again. Till we finally get rid of you. And then Michael Hayes
Michael Hayes, we got something for you in the Omni, boy. After we get rid of the big goof. And he is going to fall, Michael Hayes. And you ain't going to have nobody to hide behind in the Omni. We're going to get rid of you, boy.
It all happens tonight, 8:30 at the Omni.
Tonight, the Omni in Atlanta, 8:30, a sensational card. Such stars as Kevin Von Erich, Mr. Wrestling number 2, Steve-O, George Wells in these matches. 400-pound Chris Cannon against 300-pound Bruiser Brody. Georgia heavyweight title, Tommy Rich, champion against the superstar. And a special challenge, eighth wonder of the world, Andre the Giant and Michael Hayes, the fabulous Freebird, against Snuka and Gordy. There are good seats available. That's tonight, the Omni, 8:30.
There's the bell now. Steve-O going out against Jose Medina. Steve-O from Edina, Minnesota. Jose Medina from San Juan, Puerto Rico. Side headlock by Steve. Steve made the comment, of course, it's difficult to allow me to know exactly what he's doing and not have this information become public, but I would not divulge exactly what type of intensive training regimen he is under right now. But I can assure you of this, from the knowledge that I've been able to gather, there are going to be some people in for some very, very rude awakenings. Good flying dropkick by Steve-O. Took Medina to the canvas, and Steve-O, quick clock takedown now. On Medina, brings him back to the canvas. Steve-O maintaining that side headlock. This match, one fall with television time remaining. Good series of moves by Steve-O had Medina befuddled momentarily. Steve-O scored the takedown. They got into the ring ropes, and the referee calls for the break. Talking to my good friends, Dance and Drexel Hodge, the other day about Steve-O and the fact that he has a great future in front of him, no question about that. He goes out and absorbs knowledge like a sponge. Steve-O trapping those legs now on Jose Medina. Does two things. In cutting off the circulation and creating some problems with those muscles will slow a man considerably. Medina slips away from all that, however. A flat of the foot, one to the shoulder, one to the back of the ribs, and a forearm. Steve-O explodes back, explodes again. And Medina trying to slip away from this, turning his back to Steve-O, trying to move away from him on that bicycle, backing away now. Moves in. Steve-O in behind his man. Good takedown. Medina rolls to the ropes, forces the break. Steve-O back on his feet. Steve-O has his degree in education, a product of Gustavus Adolphus, I believe. Very, very fine college in Minnesota. Steve-O, full arm drag and twist. And Medina breaks it up. Steve-O retaliates very quickly. Medina now with forearms of Steve-O. And we got a Pier Sixer started here. Steve-O arm whips him off the ropes, catches him with an elbow, coming off. Medina driven to the canvas, trying to get it together, and Steve-O poised and ready. Steve-O again moves in on him. Neck breaker on Medina. Count of two. Near fall for Steve-O. Rips him into the turnbuckle, catches him with a shoulder into the midsection, catches him again with that shoulder just under the ribs, and now snap him to the canvas, drives the knee into the chest. Firing back, may have Steve-O in trouble. Comes off the ropes, catches him a good flying dropkick. Medina closing in again. Steve-O back on his feet, brought up. A full body slam by Jose Medina. Steve-O on that canvas. Medina comes crashing down. Steve-O rolls to one side. Steve-O very quickly moves in on Jose Medina. Arm whips and off the ropes, caught him in the pit of the stomach coming in. Steve-O moves in against him once again. Steve-O has him up and goes into the airplane spin. Steve-O into the airplane spin. He's in back to the canvas. Steve-O moving up on that top ring rope as Medina comes up very slowly. Steve-O body. Vertical body block coming off the top rope. Full body contact, keeping it within the realm of the rules and regulations. Steve-O scores the pinfall on Jose Medina. And certainly we've seen some great action here on Georgia Championship Wrestling on this first hour. I might just say a lot of other great action upcoming during the next hour of Georgia Championship Wrestling. So by all means, do stay tuned. And I think we've learned a lot about a lot of these competitors today. During the next hour, of course, we'll be seeing Bruiser Brody in action. Hopefully Andre the Giant. Snuka and Gordy wrestling too, Kevin Von Erich, and many, many more. We'll be back in just a moment. Another hour of Georgia Championship Wrestling, and before we get into any matches, I might just point out that we're going to be seeing Bruno Sammartino and the sensational Chris Cannon in action in just a couple of moments. Bruiser Brody is here, and he'll be seeing action. Steve O will be competing along with George Wells, Terry Gordy, and Jimmy Superfly Snuka. Wrestling 2, Kevin Von Erich, and a host of other great competitors will be on hand during the next hour. I'd like to remind you once again, I've had a lot of letters this past week regarding the World Heavyweight Championship and the championship matches. Obviously, the World Heavyweight Champion has to sign for title matches well in advance. May I just point out once again that in the event the world champion loses his title on any given night, the very, very next night or the very, very next match that that champion is scheduled to have, no matter where it is, that contract must be fulfilled by the new champion. So consequently, of course, right now, Dusty Rhodes is the NWA World Heavyweight Champion. Should he lose his title, and heaven forbid that he would, but should he lose his title, the very next title match that was upcoming, whoever defeated Dusty for that title would then have to fulfill those contractual obligations. I thought I'd straighten that out once again for all of you who've written letters. We've had some tremendous mail response recently from New Orleans, Shreveport, Seattle, Washington, places all over the country. Certainly a delight to hear from all of you. And as I've said before, we can't answer all of those letters personally, but I can assure you we do read them, and that is one answer I wanted to get out over the network today regarding the World Heavyweight Championship. Let's say great action coming up, so now here's our ring announcer.
This event won fall with a 10-minute time limit from Cincinnati, Ohio. Introducing, making his first appearance, Jeff Sword. Jeff Sword. His team partner, David Sierra. David Sierra. Their opponents from Pittsburgh at 225 pounds, Bruno Sammartino Jr. His team partner from Houston, Texas at 401 pounds, here's Big Chris Cannon. Chris Cannon, the referee George Scott Jr. will be back with this match right after this.
Bruno Sammartino Jr. moving out against Dave Sierra. This match, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Sierra moves in against Sammartino. Jeff Sword out of Cincinnati, Ohio. That's Sierra in the ring with Bruno Sammartino right now, however. Sammartino, at the age of 19, I've said before, was named the world's strongest teenager. He has been in the pro ranks now about 2 years. San Martino up and over his man. Cross body block, well executed. Tried for an early pinfall. Referee. George Scott Jr. watching him carefully. The count is on, and it is Chris Cannon moving out there. Chris Cannon, and he is a big fellow indeed. Sierra rips across the eye. Sierra tried a shoulder smash, and he might just as well run into a Sherman tank. And Sword tried it and met with the same fate. Cannon, 6'6", over 400 pounds. And Sword trying to bring him up for a full body slam and just absolutely could not move him. Cannon takes care of that problem. Cannon, by the way, was a New Jersey State heavyweight wrestling champion, and it is certainly not hard to understand that. Big, massive individual, extremely powerful. Snapmare takes Sword to the canvas. And just to show you the diversity of this man, his favorite hobbies and pastimes, working out with the weights, and golf. And I understand he plays a pretty mean game of golf. Sword has him up against the turnbuckle, starts to bring him off, and Cannon hangs on, reverses on Sword, whips him into that far turnbuckle. And for anybody going up against this man, Ken, it would have to be a very discouraging situation to face somebody that big and that powerful. I can think of few men who would rank in that same size category. You'd talk about men like Andre the Giant. Bruiser Brody would be another one who would certainly be up in that same height, weight, and power category. Although there's a vast difference between the physical structure of Cannon and Brody. Both men do have the size, the weight, and the strength. Cannon out of Glassboro State College, and Sierra pounding away with hard right hands now. And Cannon smashed into that turnbuckle, and so Sierra may have found a weak spot here. Using those right hands to the jaw may have created some problems for Cannon, and now Bruno Sammartino Jr. moves out. Sammartino Jr. from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Sammartino using that femoris muscles across the chest of Sierra. Sierra now has Sammartino up, forearm. Sammartino retaliates. Sierra rips across the eyes. All right, Sierra trying to press that advantage now on Sammartino Jr. And Bruno will be... Sierra makes the tag, a cheap shot on Sammartino.
We got him now, Gordon Sullivan!
And you can hear Sierra shouting something about, we got him now. Well, it doesn't look that way to me. Bruno Sammartino Jr. moving against Sword rather effectively, a full body slam. Backdrop. Put Sword back to the canvas. Sammartino, back of the elbow across the chest. Near fall for Sammartino. Cannon, having made the tag, comes off the rope. Across the chest of Ted Sword out of Cincinnati, Ohio, plus the added force of that body coming down across him had to do exactly what it did do, put Sword out. And so Chris Cannon and Bruno Sammartino Jr. victorious in their match. And I want to take a couple of moments right now to talk to two men who certainly are more used to having their names in the victory column than in the loss column. Referring, of course, to Wrestling 2 to my right and Tommy Rich, the Georgia heavyweight champion, to my left. And Tommy, I might just point out that this most popular wrestler contest, we're certainly getting a tremendous response from all of the people. And I might just point out that you're getting quite a vote.
Well, thank you very much, Gordon. You know, and I'd like to thank all the people out there. You know, just like I've said time and time again, without them, Tommy Rich wouldn't be where he's at. And I just want to thank all of them. It's good to be here in Georgia.
And obviously, it goes without saying, of course, the gentleman to my right has always been certainly one of the most popular wrestlers in competition.
Thank you very much, Gordon. You know, those postcards are coming in just so fast. Man, I'm just so grateful for all those postcards and you wonderful fans out there. Keep up the good work, because I'm really looking forward to walking out of here with that big trophy in my arms. You know, it's going to be a great victory for me.
Well, it is indeed for whomever wins it. I might just point out, if you want to send your postcards in naming your favorite wrestler, send it to 100 Techwood Drive Northwest, Atlanta, Georgia, 30303. Let's talk further to the Georgia heavyweight champion about that title. I must admit, you have certainly been a fighting champion.
Well, thank you very much, Gordon. You know, just like I said before, you know, I'm the people's champion, and anytime, you know, just like I said, I've got an open contract, and I told the superstar anytime, anywhere, any place he wants a match, I'm more than glad to give him one.
Well, obviously, there are a lot of other people who are looking to gain that title, and I know you have...
I'd like to say this. I'd like to say he has been a good champion, but you know, he hasn't wrestled me yet.
Well, I can understand that. And obviously, the two of you are very, very close friends. But nonetheless, once you step into that squared circle, that friendship ends. But it's a pleasure to have with me the Georgia heavyweight champion, Tommy Wildfire Rich, and Mr. Wrestling Number Two. Nice to have visiting with us in the television sports studio today, Mr. Bill Apter, the managing editor of Inside Wrestling and managing editor of GC London Publishing Company. You might have seen him occasionally coming into camera view, and certainly a pleasure to have him along today. And I'd like to remind all of you, too, of course, that beginning next week, we're going to be starting the program promptly at 6:05.
Very good, Gordon. That's the new time starting Saturday, September 5th for two solid hours, 6:05. Saturdays, 5:35, the regular time, Sundays for Best Of, here on the Superstation.
And we certainly hope that all of you will mark that down and make it. Now, that'll be a permanent starting time, 6:05 from now on until we inform you differently. And, of course, right now we need to take a look at where wrestling will be held all over this great country.
Great action, Gordon. Thursday, September 10th, Valdosta, Mathis Auditorium at 8:30. Tuesday, September 8th, West Point, Georgia. Sunday, September 6th, a week from tomorrow, the Cobb County Civic Center, Marietta, 8 o'clock. On Saturday, September 5th, a week from tonight, Chattanooga, the Memorial Auditorium, 8:15, and in Carrollton at 8:30. On Friday, September 4th, Gainesville, Georgia at 8:30 at the Georgia Mountain Center, and in Pavo, Georgia at the high school gym. On this coming Thursday, the 3rd of September, Waycross, the City Auditorium. Wednesday, September 2nd, Columbus, Georgia. Tuesday, September 1st, Macon, Georgia. This Monday night, Augusta, Bell Auditorium. Tomorrow evening, a big one, and Andre the Giant will make it that much bigger. In Columbus, Ohio at 7:30, a sensational card. Great seats still available. Tomorrow afternoon, 2 o'clock, Huntington, West Virginia at the Cabell County Memorial Fieldhouse. Another great card tomorrow for the folks in Huntington. Here's the full card, though, for tonight. The big ones right here in Atlanta at the Omni. Here's the rundown. Watch. Tonight, the Omni in Atlanta, 8:30, a sensational card. Such stars as Kevin Von Erich, Mr. Wrestling Number Two, Steve-O, George Wells in these matches. 400-pound Chris Cannon against 300-pound Bruiser Brody. Georgia heavyweight title, Tommy Rich, champion, against the superstar. And a special challenge, eighth wonder of the world, Andre the Giant and Michael Hayes, the fabulous Freebird, against Snuka and Gordy. There are good seats available. That's tonight, the Omni, 8:30.
Bruiser Brody going up against Mitch Barlow. Now here, we were seeing Canyon in action just a moment ago, and take a look at this man, Brody. He is after Barlow before Barlow had a chance to get it together. Brody was on top of him. Brody has him out, full body slam. You talk about a superbly conditioned athlete in all respects. Here is a man who is, well, I guess a lot of people would describe as humongous, and he is. Brody using the flat of the foot right to the side of the head and into the head once again of Barlow. And Barlow has had just no opportunity whatsoever to get it together. Brody hurdled his man through the ropes, and Barlow came down on his head outside on the concrete, trying to get back to his feet. And Brody smashing him on the ring apron once again, and Brody now using the foot into the throat of Barlow. At this point in time, is just no contest at all for Brody. Brody does. He is intimidating physically, mentally, and capability-wise. He is absolutely and totally intimidating. Has tremendous intensity. Has one thought and one thought in mind when he steps into that ring, and that's to completely destroy anything in his way. And yet he's a curious mixture of individuals. He has a strange ego and sincerely wonders sometimes why some people just don't like him. Barlow moving up very slowly, fire to the midsection, had absolutely no effect on Brody at all. Brody again brings him up a full body slam. Well, you talk about big men, and we're talking about big men. Count of three, count of three. I'll tell you one thing. A guy like Brody ought to really step into the ring with somebody his own size, like a man like, well, Canyon or Andre the Giant, Mulligan, people who are well over 6 feet tall and in the 300 to 400 pound weight bracket. Because I don't believe there's anybody else who can give this man any sort of real competition. He's just real, real big and real, real dangerous. Well, you hear the music. That indicates only one thing. The original Fabulous Freebird, Michael Hayes, and look who he's got with him.
Baby, I said I would get my man.
Easy. Yeah, easy.
It took a little while, but I got the man here. And if you notice, he is feeling nasty. You see, he got the shirt unbuttoned. Let me get that dressing on. Oh, yeah. He got the grubby face. I love it. He ain't going to shave. Tell him what you going to do, big baby. He going to get a hold of baby Huey.
All right, obviously here.
Ready? I got my man, you understand?
A really very, very confident Michael Hayes, the Fabulous Freebird, moving out with the eighth wonder of the world, my good friend from Grenoble, France, Andre the Giant, 7 feet, 4 inches tall, averages around 450 pounds, depending on...
85 pounds.
Now up to 485, and you haven't grown any shorter, that is for sure.
Good. Even after 2 months in the hospital, I'm more than very good, and I'm ready to wrestling some different way. Because they want to wrestling dirty, I go to wrestling dirty too, because I'm going to show you I can wrestling dirty anytime I want.
Well, all right. Let's start then with tonight in the Omni, because of course...
Wait a minute, before we go to the Omni, let's go somewhere and drink some Tennessee whiskey and get right.
How many gallons you get?
As many as you want to do, baby, because tonight in the Omni...
I want 2 barrels.
I've been waiting for this for 6 long weeks. And I tell you, you say you got a surprise? Ooh la, we do, we got something for you. When I get it, everybody's going to know just exactly what I've been talking about and just exactly what I've been waiting for. And I just want to say this to you, since you are kind enough to do what you're doing for me. I know you don't like me, but you're doing it anyway. In Huntington, in Columbus, anywhere, I will be watching your back.
I just want you to sit in that corner and give me that whiskey and let me do the whole.
Ah, Nasty, baby. Fantasia. Tonight in the Omni, baby. Andre and the Freebird gonna fly.
There are gonna be some dues paid tonight at the Omni here in Atlanta. Steve-O and George Wells moving out against Denny Brown and Jim Nelson, and that is Nelson being upended by Wells. Wells brings him up. Good flying head scissors. Wells has him up against the ring ropes, arm whips him into the far side, makes the tag. Steve-O catches him coming in. And Steve-O with kind of a strange chop to the side of the head. Steve-O now with a side headlock. Steve-O front face locking, and Denny Brown trying to get away from it. George Wells in there now. Hip lock takedown on Brown. Has him to the canvas. Wow, Wells caught him that time. Comes over, makes the tag with Steve-O. Single leg pickup by Steve-O. Comes down across those femoris muscles. And it was Brown turning that to his own advantage momentarily, a rear face lock. Wells back into the ring. Inside step over on the left leg of Brown. Wells back on his feet very quickly after Denny Brown. Ropes. Wells brings him up, presses him above his head into a full body slam. And Brown had to feel that one from the tips of his toes to the top of his head, makes the tag. And Nelson hesitating before he got in the ring. Nelson, very quick arm drag takedown, takes him off his feet. Arm drag takedown once again by Steve-O. As Wells had tagged up. Steve-O breaks it up as Nelson trying to press the advantage. Good arm drag takedown by Steve-O. Once again makes the tag with George Wells. Wells drove that knee into the shoulder of Jim Nelson. Nelson brought down again by Wells. Wells, there you can see an excellent example of the spinae recti muscles on Wells. Excellent definition. Again, the tag is made. Steve-O moves back into the ring. Steve-O, snapmare. As Nelson to the canvas, Steve-O catches him with a knee. Arm drag takedown again by Steve-O. So Nelson, who is a totally aggressive competitor, finding his hands full with this combination. Nelson pulls him back to the ropes. Referee calls for the break. Nelson tries to catch him on the break and does so. Now makes the tag with Denny Wolf. Denny Brown, rather. And Brown, wasting no time, punishing Steve-O. Hip lock takedown. Steve-O tries to roll him into a pinning combination. Denny Brown rolls away from it. Belly to back suplex by Steve-O, and that may be he makes the tag with George Wells, and so Wells moves in. Wells would be another one that I wouldn't mind seeing going up against Bruiser Brody. Fellas like Wells, Andre the Giant, Chris Canyon, Mulligan, all of these fellas, I think, could give Mr. Brody a run for his money. Steve-O makes the tag once again, moves back in. Hip lock takedown. Steve-O keeps that side headlock on Denny Wolf. Referee watching carefully now into those ropes. Denny Wolf drives a knee to the midsection. Off the ropes, and Steve-O is caught that time by Denny Wolf. Wolf catches him again, another hard right hand as Steve-O retaliates a savage right hand to the side of the jaw. And a chop across the throat. Again, the tag is made. George Wells moves in. Brown softened up, caught with a flying dropkick by Wells. And Nelson breaks it up. And the referee warning Nelson about his tactics. The referee keeping those eyes open, watching him very carefully. High backdrop by Wells. Off the ropes, crashes down across Brown, rather. Had the count of three as it was Nelson started to charge, and Steve-O broke that up. And now Wells in there making sure that that stops. And as Brown started to interfere again, it was Wells breaking it up. And so the winners of this match, in certainly no uncertain terms, George Wells and Steve-O.
The odds of being struck by lightning are a billion to one. But my odds of winning Crystal's get-rich-quick game are up to me.
There's a new chance to win on every Crystal box. So the more I play, the more I can win. I can collect lucky Ks and win the big cash bonus prize at every Crystal. Or win thousands of other prizes instantly. It's one game where the odds are on your side. Right, girls?
Yeah! Wow, Crystal craving, wow!
I must say that I have to admire both these men for some very, very specific reasons. Because I don't think either one of these men really know the meaning of the word fear.
Hey, that's right. You know, heard Michael Hayes out here talking. You know, he's really got the nerve standing out here calling people names. You know, Michael Hayes, I'm far from being a baby boy. I'm far from being a baby. And as a matter of fact, I'm old man. And this man standing beside me right here, he's all man. And you put us together, two men together, we like to get nasty. You know, I heard you out here talking about getting nasty. And you're saying Andre's going to get a little nasty too. Well, baby, there's nobody, and I mean nobody, that can get as nasty as the Superfly and the Master of Disaster. And like I said, boy, I'm far from being a baby.
Well, first of all, tonight at the Omni, you and Superfly Snuka going up against Michael Hayes and Andre the Giant. Now, surely, do you honestly think you got a chance against Andre the Giant?
Hey, like I said before, and like I'll say again, Gordon Solie, it's like this. The man's too big. He might have the size, he might have the strength, but he hasn't got it all. He hasn't got the size, the strength, the speed, and the agility. So tonight in the Omni, the big man's going to fall. Everybody in Atlanta going to think there's going to be a big explosion when he hits. But it might not happen just once. It's going to happen a bunch of times, because every time he gets up, the big man's going to fall. And then Michael Hayes, you're going to be left all alone, and we're going to get on you, boy, so bad. And it's going to be worser than your face being rubbed in a mat. It's going to be maybe an arm broke right here in the Omni tonight.
Well, we're going to find out. Here's a complete rundown.
Tonight, The Omni in Atlanta, 8:30, a sensational card. Such stars as Kevin Von Erich, Mr. Wrestling number 2, Steve-O, George Wells in these matches. 400-pound Chris Cannon against 300-pound Bruiser Brody. Georgia heavyweight title, Tommy Rich, champion against the superstar. And a special challenge, eighth wonder of the world, Andre the Giant and Michael Hayes, the fabulous Freebird, against Snuka and Gordy. There are good seats available. That's tonight, the Omni, 8:30.
Australian tag team match. Terry Gordy and Jimmy Superfly Snuka moving up against the combination now. Gilbert in there offering plenty of punishment now. Gordy trapped on those ring ropes, and he's facing a very, very aggressive competitor. Now Terry Gordy exploding with those forearms. Snap mare that takes him back to the canvas once again. So Terry Gordy and Superfly Snuka. They are the, as I said, of course, the Georgia Tag Team Champions. Gordy has not been competing that long as a professional, but he has great natural talent, great natural ability. There you see them double teaming. Snuka, however, has been 10 years in the ring, born in the Fiji Islands. Went to high school in Hawaii and Hawaii State College. And I might point out that Snuka not only is an outstanding wrestler, but also is an outstanding amateur boxer. Great speed. There he makes the tag, and wait a minute. Michael Hayes has just appeared upon the scene. Michael Hayes. And this is caught. Wait a second. There is the eighth wonder of the world. Now, Michael Hayes is 6'1", and look at the way Andre the Giant towers over him. Andre the Giant at better than 480 pounds now, and the two of them watching this match, and obviously Michael Hayes pointing out Snuka and Gordy to Andre, and of course, Snuka and Gordy have caused Michael Hayes a lot of embarrassment, a lot of strife. And may I just say that as long as they stay outside the ring, everything's all right. And the referee concerned about that, too. And Gordy continues to move against his opponent, but Michael Hayes and Andre the Giant standing outside watching this with more than casual interest. And Gordy continues to be upset over the fact that these two are outside the ring. I might point out they have done nothing. They have made no moves whatsoever. Collar and elbow once again. Snuka, driven back to the turnbuckle, makes the tag with Gordy. And Gordy sundays his man, and then Snuka gets in a cheap shot. Between the count on the break. And let's face it. And Gordy. And Gordy may be having some mental process problems right now. The disconcertment being caused by Andre and Michael Hayes outside the ring. Maybe messing up Gordy's thought processes. He's back to concentrating on his opponent right now, but you notice he keeps looking over. And is, in fact, I would think, more concerned about Hayes and Andre than he is about the opponents in the ring. And that could be a very dangerous mistake. Although Snuka, the cool seasoned veteran, moves out there now. And although he was upset initially, seems now to have put Hayes and Andre aside. He's concentrating on his man in the ring. A snapmare takes him to the canvas. Snuka using those feet again so very effectively. Hey, boot to the midsection, and Gordy now with a snapmare after making the tag with the super foul. And the crowd here watching the match and also watching very carefully to see what Hayes and Andre the Giant might be up to. But I can't help but feel that theirs is purely a psychological bit of warfare outside the ring, just to see how much worry they can put on the team of Snook and Gordy. Snooka has extremely fast hands and fast feet. Good forearm that puts his opponent back to the canvas once again. And Snooka had his attention diverted momentarily, was caught in the midsection as he took some of his time to talk to Andre and Michael Hayes. Terry Gordy going after the man who was tagged up. Michael Hayes and Andre the Giant still standing there very quietly. Still no interference of any kind. And this, of course, is something that is a constant worry to everyone. And now Gordy could be in trouble here. A series of right hands to the head. Gordy backing away. And so maybe the diversionary tactics of Michael Hayes and Andre the Giant are beginning to work, because Gordy has found himself in definite trouble. And so, tag team combination after him. Gordy trying to recoup it now. Comes off the ropes. Snooka makes the tag. Superfly whips him into the turnbuckle, catches him. Brings him out. Beautiful vertical souple. Well executed. And again, Snooka, you see, is having his attention diverted, and once again making the comments, but now backing away. Terry Gordy has his man, brings him up for the pile driver. That has to be the end. It is. It is. A merciful end, I might add, that the pile driver is so devastating. And so the Georgia Tag Team Champions, Terry Gordy and Superfly Jimmy Snooka, are victorious. And notice the cautious manner in which they're backing away. And I think they're judging the character of Michael Hayes and Andre the Giant by their own character, which means that they wouldn't be the least bit opposed to jumping somebody from behind. But that is not the character of Andre the Giant, that's for sure. The winners, Snooka and Gordy. Well, I wanted to have a few words with Bruiser Brody, and I guess...
Sully, you see what I have here? I have the official ballot box for the most important and favored wrestler in the United States. Now, let me show you something. All this talk about Tommy Rich wrestling too. Let me tell you something. When the ballots are cast, everybody, and I mean everybody, knows that it'll be me who wins the most favorite wrestling contest. Now, the second point I want to make sure everybody realizes is you don't see Cowboy Mulligan hanging around. And you won't see him hanging around no more. Because a week ago, I put him in the hospital in Roanoke, Virginia. So right now, the thing between Bruiser Brody and Blackjack Mulligan is over. It's finished.
Well, tonight, you've got Chris Cannon in the Omni, over 400 pounds.
Let me tell you something. I got 400-pound Crippler Canyon tonight, and I got Andre the Giant in Columbus, Ohio. Now, when I went over to the NWA wrestling office and stole this ballot box, I had two reasons in mind. That was to take both of those great, big, fat, overstuffed excuses for wrestlers and stick them in what I call my homemade coffin. When I get done with Crippler Canyon, I'm going to beat him up, and I'm going to tuck him over here in this half. And then I'm going to take this big casket with me all the way to Columbus, Ohio. I'm going to beat the you-know-what out of that big giant, and I'm going to stuff him in the other half of this box. I'm going to slam the lid closed, and I'm going to take it over to the local sewer and drop it in with the rest of the slop.
What can I tell you about that, man? He is something else again. Here's our ring announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, this event one fall with television time remaining. Introducing first from Tokyo, Japan, at 242 pounds, Professor Sonoda. Professor Sonoda. His team partner from Decatur at 255 pounds. Here's Ed Timms. Ed Timms. Their opponents, ladies and gentlemen, one of wrestling's all-time greats at 237 pounds. Here's Mr. Wrestling number two. Wrestling number two. His team partner from one of wrestling's most famous families from Denton, Texas. Here's Kevin Von Erich. Kevin Von Erich.
Kevin Von Erich and Wrestling 2 going up against Professor Sonoda and Ed Timms. Interesting thing on Sonoda, of course, born and raised in Japan. He has a black belt in judo. He came to the United States, has been competing professionally for a couple of years now, and has adapted to the American style of wrestling. He has put together a combination of the American catch-as-catch-can style with the Japanese knowledge of the martial arts, and has done extremely well with it. High backdrop there. Wrestling 2 caught him very quickly. Sonoda backing away from that. Unlike many other Japanese wrestlers, Sonoda, if you'll note, wears boots. Many of the Japanese wrestlers do not, but he does, and he uses them very, very effectively, I might add. His partner, Ed Timms, has an impressive amateur background. Wrestling and football. Played left tackle in high school. Kevin Von Erich out there now, and Von Erich, second-generation wrestler, and just an outstanding young athlete. Interesting situation. Snuka and Gordy made some challenges, and Von Erich, who has been interrupted twice now in interviews with me, told him that he would take on either one of them in a single match. And I'd be curious to find out. Hopefully next week we may have a match between Von Erich and either Terry Gordy or Superfly Jimmy Snuka. That, of course, is something that is not known positively at this time, but certainly if there's any way that match can be arranged, I'm sure it will be. Von Erich, good step over on the leg. Crotch hook and take down and makes the tag with Wrestling 2. Full arm drag and twist by Wrestling 2 on Sonoda. Wrestling 2, by the way. Has an interesting series of hobbies. Von Erich caught him coming off the ropes. Caught him across the head and almost tore his head off that time. Brings him up again. Full body slam. Hooks the far leg. Sonoda powers out before the count of three. Sonoda catches him a chop into the throat. Von Erich, right forearm into the side of the jaw. And it's Sonoda punishing him now, and now Ed Timms in there punishing Von Erich. And Von Erich, not finished with Sonoda, catches him once again. Now, as we mentioned earlier about Von Erich, he does lacerate and bruise very, very easily. He is not like so many wrestlers. He has absolutely no excess. His skin is drawn very tautly over his body, and you'll notice he's already got, in this match, a rather bad rope burn across his back. As Von Erich turns, you can see it across the lower extremity of his back, just under the shoulder blades, actually. Tim's caught again. Tim's, by the way, championship caliber rook player. Which doesn't seem to be helping him a bit here in the ring right now. Wrestling 2 brings him up full body slam. Referee checking those shoulders, started the count. Sonata starts to come in, and Wrestling 2 lets him know about it in a hurry. Kevin Von Erich, full arm drag and twist now on Ev Timms. For this match, one fall, a 10-minute time limit. Well, it's interesting to see how long Tommy Wildfire Rich will hold on to that Georgia Heavyweight Championship. A lot of challenges coming his way. Wrestling 2 moves in with that knee lift, has Timms in trouble. Snapmare on Timms brings him back to the canvas once again. Wrestling 2 with a rear chin lock. Wrestling 2 caught him again. High knee lift as Sonata back to the canvas. Sonata makes the tag. Ed Timms moves in. And Wrestling 2, short chopping right hand. Wrestling 2 stalks his man now. Timms. High backdrop. Crashes back to the canvas once again and comes up rather slowly. Knee lift that caught him. Makes the tag with Kevin Von Erich, and Timms in trouble. Von Erich after Sonata. Beautiful move by Von Erich. Up and off that top rope. And a full crashing body press across the body of Ed Timms. And so the victor in this situation, certainly the tag team combination of Kevin Von Erich and Mr. Wrestling number 2. We will have a standby match coming up. Let's move back to the ring once again. I believe we're going to be seeing Iron Mike Sharp in action, so let's turn it over to the ring. Iron Mike Sharp going up against Jerry Mahoney. There's the bell. Iron Mike Sharp out of Canada. Mahoney, big, not quite as big as Iron Mike Sharp, and he just found out that an attack with a shoulder smash, particularly early on in the match here, is not the thing to do. Full Nelson by Jerry Mahoney. Iron Mike Sharp trapped in there, but look at the great power that he has. Putting into full utilization all of the muscles in the back. Latissimus dorsi, the trapezius, deltoids, and all. And Iron Mike Sharp just flat overpowered Mahoney that time. Sharp, massive upper and lower body. Big, powerful football-like legs. Mahoney now with that side headlock on Sharp. Sharp, like a bag of potatoes, just picked him up and threw him aside. Sharp is another one who has to rank with some of the super heavyweights in competition today. Mahoney breaks it up. Mahoney had that fist double up, and I can't say that I blame him. Sharp has manhandled him pretty effective. Ah, good move by Mahoney. Fainted for the shoulder. Dropped into a single leg pickup. Sharp into those ring ropes. The referee then calls for the break. All right, they lock up collar and elbow once again. And time rapidly running out in this match. Talking to some friends of mine, Eric and Joe Lynn, the other day. Time running out for them, and both men squaring away now at each other. And Mike Sharp offering his hand. But Mahoney, let's see what happens here. And a mistake on Mahoney's part. Took that preferred hand and suddenly found out that Sharp is the kind that'll take full advantage of any situation that he's given. Full body slam by Iron Mike Sharp. Mahoney brought up again, another full body slam. Iron Mike Sharp sets him for the... Looks like he's going for the pile driver, does not. Goes for a reverse backbreaker. Has that reverse backbreaker. It's a... In effect, a variation of a gut wrench, really. But Iron Mike Sharp, devastating Jerry Mahoney, using that reverse backbreaker, used it very, very effectively, scored the submission. And so it is all over for Jerry Mahoney. And let me have a word or two with Mr. Sharp, if I can, because not many people use a backbreaker in that particular way, but you use it.
There's not very many people that got the strength I have, and I demonstrated in there, and I'll demonstrate it against anybody in the ring there. And I'm getting a little sick and tired about the way I'm being treated here in Georgia. I'm not getting the matches I deserve, the matches that I want. You know, I'm a number one man. I'm a big, powerful man. I've got a terrific record. I'm a little bit tired of the people around here. You got all the titles and the glory and the money. And I want my chance to get in there and show you people out there and show the promoters and show everybody that I'm number one.
Well, I'm certainly not going to argue with him at this point in time, that's for sure. Until next week, then, at 6:05, Gordon Solie saying so long from the Peach State of Georgia.
Thanks for watching Georgia Championship Wrestling. The announcers on this program are employed by Georgia Championship Wrestling, Incorporated. Join us again next week for Georgia Championship Wrestling.